We've been exploring how the brain copes with both aging and how it responds to fitness training or aerobic fitness training. Walking is the main intervention we use with our older adults. And in that body of studies, we've looked at changes in brain structure using magnetic resonance imaging, finding that older adults who participate in these programs expand the volume of a number of areas of cortex, both gray matter, kind of the cell bodies or the neurons or glia, the supporting structure, as well as the white matter or the interconnections among the neurons or the cell bodies in a variety of areas from the prefrontal cortex, temporal cortex, as well as an area called the anterior commissure that allows the brain to communicate between the hemispheres. So there have been increases in structure. We've also looked at changes in function as a function of these fitness training interventions using functional magnetic resonance imaging and with our colleagues Monica Fabiani and Gabriele Gratone, near-infrared spectroscopy and event-related optical signals. And what we found there is that older adults, again, who go through a six-month training period, 3 days a week, about an hour a day, walking, start out slow, go a little faster. Nobody's winning any races here, but certainly they're walking further and faster. But after this six-month period, the networks, the neural networks that support the perceptual and cognitive abilities tend to become more efficient. Actually, they look more like the neural networks that are observed for younger people, much younger people. So that's an interesting finding. More recently, we've been doing a year-long study, that is 50 weeks, three times a week, or 150 sessions, and assessing changes in cognition with behavioral measures, brain structure and brain function with MRI and functional magnetic resonance imaging over the course of the year, before 6 months and after the intervention, and finding some very interesting changes in targeted areas of the brain. And we're almost done with that study. Will be done in about another 6 months. So there are a multitude of changes at the behavioral level, at the brain structure level, and at the brain function level with humans. We do a variety of projects, both at the Beckman Institute and in collaboration with others pretty much throughout the United States and across the world on cognitive training. We've looked at very specific programs of training we've come up with to train older people in the ability to multitask, given the demands in today's world that we do many things quickly or switch quickly among tasks. And we've had some success there in adaptive individualized training, computer-based training of older adults. More recently, we've looked at the utility of off-the-shelf video games. We used a video game called Rise of Nations, which is a strategy-based game. And we asked whether we could train higher level cognitive abilities that fall under this general heading of executive control, planning, scheduling, dealing with ambiguity, multitasking, working memory, by virtue of having these older adults practice this game for about 3 or 4 weeks. And we found some very promising data there. We did find some benefits on some standard neuropsychological tests. We also do work with our colleagues at Johns Hopkins on a really neat program called Experience Core, in which older adults who are pretty low fit, older, 75 years of age, poor education, eighth grade level on average, poor socioeconomic status, and in the present case, 100% African-American women, we get them involved in a program in which they're trained to provide literacy support, numeracy support, behavioral management support, and library support in kindergarten through third grade. They're trained for several months. They go into the schools in teams of about 10 to 15. They work 15 hours a week with the kids, the kindergartners through third graders, and we assess them both with behavioral measures of various aspects of cognition as well as brain measures using the MRI systems available at the hospital complex at Johns Hopkins. And we found similar effects to what we found with our fitness interventions. And when you think of Experience Core, it's truly multimodal. It involves becoming more physically fit. Those little chairs we used to sit in when we were kids, imagine being 75 and frail and popping up and out of those chairs. Certainly social. They work with other people. They work with kids. They work with teachers. A lot of these people are pretty isolated that are in this program. It's cognitively and emotionally challenging. So it really incorporates a multitude of aspects of lifestyle that we know from a variety of different studies that have studied social interaction and physical activity and intellectual challenge separately are good for us. Improved cognition can ward off, at least to a limited extent, neurodegenerative diseases like Alzheimer's disorder, but it's all put together here. It's all conglomerated or integrated, as it is in most real-world tasks, and it's something people really enjoy. Generally, one of the problems with a lot of these interventions is that, especially physical activity training or physical fitness, is that people become disinterested or life gets in the way and they no longer participate. So participation rates tend to decline with time, especially in physical activity training. With the Experience Corps project at Johns Hopkins, we had a 95% maintenance rate, so 95% of people who started finished, because it's something that's meaningful to people. So those are some of the cognitive and multimodal programs we've been involved in. There are others. Exercise tends to provoke a number of changes or engender a number of changes, including building new connections among neurons called synaptogenesis, building new vascular structure to deal with increased demands called angiogenesis, even constructing new neurons from adult stem cells or progenitor cells. That's very limited, occurs mostly in two regions of the brain, and the hippocampus has been the area that's been studied. So a number of structural changes that lead to more efficient neural networks, but also increases in gene expression of proteins such as neurotrophins. There are a number of these neurotrophins that are neuroprotective, and they engender the structural changes. So although there's still much to be learned, we've learned quite a bit from non-human animal research about the molecular and cellular changes that take place with fitness change training, or just a variety of different training scenarios with young organisms as well as older organisms. Well, as my daughter said about 10 years ago now, when we had a little article written about us in USA Today, "Be smart, exercise your heart." That was her soundbite that I think at 7 she was published in USA Today. Not bad. But I like it, because what it suggests is that you can get smarter in a sense. That is, you can improve various aspects of perception and cognition if you take a walk or take a few walks. Many people ask me, well, do we really have to get involved in running or lifting weights, or do we really have to sweat a lot? Sweating works, but you don't have to. You just have to do more than what you're doing. So the intervention we use is walking, and people come into our program and they don't walk much. In our society in the United States, we don't walk much. Some cultures work more than we do. But they get involved in walking further and maybe a little bit faster with friends, and that's pretty much what it takes. So it's not overly challenging. Nobody's winning triathlons or senior Olympics. That'd be great if they were. But it's really pretty moderate exercise. And there's no good reason not to do it. Even if you've got physical conditions that make it hard to walk, swim, ride a bike. There are many options. I actually meet people in the street that talk about this research on fitness training and its effects on brain and cognition, and that's a literature that we've contributed to here at the Beckman Institute. So I think people are starting to hear about it. It used to be that physical fitness was talked about with respect to maintaining a healthy heart or a healthy body, and that's all true. It really has a multitude of effects, but it also allows you to maintain a healthy mind and brain. And I think it's getting out there in a variety of different forms, from print media to blogs, to videos, to the evening news. And I hope people are taking it seriously. I do.